Hello and welcome to myself, Jamie of GEOSynths, and we're back with episode 44 of the GEOSynths Synth Show. Blah, blah, blah. I'm going to have to get a better title than that. There's too many S's in there. I hope you're all doing very, very well and that your Facebook pages and emails haven't been completely bombarded with NAMM show talk. It seems like, you know, the latest release gets posted about 10,000 times on each group. So you must be living under a rock here if you haven't been hearing about things that have been going on in NAMM. So hello, everyone in the chat room. Let's see who we've got. We've got JP Baguettu. Hello to you. We've got Inky, which is Lisa. Good to see you, Lisa. We've got Jazz. Hi, Jazz. Phil Taylor. Sasquatch. Oral Sonic Waves. John Simpson. Hello, John. Hope you're very well. We've got Chris Davey. Hi, Chris. What have you bought this time? Have you swapped something else, Chris? We've got Aaron, who's imperfect. And we've got J-Rod and Phil Taylor. So, hello, everybody. No doubt we'll be talking about things that happened in NAMM. We've got Rockman Rock. Hello to you and Wombra. Quite a few people coming in now, actually. So, yes, as I said, we'll be talking about some of the instruments, some of the latest synths and other gear that have come out in NAMM. But, of course, as you know, I like to have guests on the show. And, you know, last week it was Ben Simpson. We had a few technical troubles. He couldn't actually hear me, so he did a great job actually trying to read my lips. Which is a little bit strange, and but he did very, very well. But this time, it's a little bit different. Rather than just focusing on synths and so on, it's all related. But I asked somebody to join the show who many of you, I'm sure, will know, and that is Mr. Darren E. Cowley. Darren, thanks very much for joining. How are you doing?
Wonderful. Yeah, Sunday afternoon, roast is put away. Looking forward to this chat.
Roast is put away. And he's got himself a nice glass of red wine there. Sadly, I've only got the Coke myself, but and that's the drinking kind. So,
yes.
But yes, so Darren, let's just show you your website, actually. Darren of Isotonik Studios. So we've got, you want to go to his website? It's isotonikstudios.com. So Darren is the founder of Isotonik Studios, which specializes in developing tools for Ableton, Max for Live, and making hardware controllers scripts. They also develop software editors and provide sound packs and libraries for Ableton and other instruments. And there's quite a lot of different instruments and scripts. And this was quite an interesting one, actually. This Factoid Time Randomizer, which I'll just have a quick play of, actually. Essentially, it's taking audio and you can rejig it around and use it like an arpeggiator or redo drums in a different pattern. But we'll get a little bit more into that in a moment. But yes, we have Darren. And hello. And can you tell me, music, how did all of this start for you?
Pretty standard, to be fair. As a kid, Sunday night, top 40, taping the charts, trying to cut out the DJ's talking in between. And then listening back to it during the week, I think my first record I ever bought was A-E-I-O-U by Friends.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant track. That was, what is?
Kind of still love, to
yeah,
be fair.
Yeah,
first album was Uptown Girl by Billy Joel, which was primarily bought for my mum rather than myself. yeah, kind of started just getting into music that way. My mum loved music, my dad not greatly. He hasn't got a single CD in his collection. So I think that tells you the kind of influence I had from him on that basis.
So music sort of grew within you, and of course, you know, you grew up in the 80s and early 90s, so that was a fantastic period for music, especially electronic music. What kind of things sort of really stood out for you? What inspired you?
To be fair, my first job was working behind the record bar at Woolworths. On a Sunday night, I generally got to go in and work in the stock room and label up all the new releases. And if you were clever enough, you'd put the new release to the back of a shelf that no one else could find. And then in 2 weeks' time, that got reduced. So I'd be Sunday night playing these new releases to myself and deciding which ones I'd want to buy in a couple of weeks. And the sort of stuff I was getting, like Dougie Fresh, The Show, the electro albums. I was very much at that point electronic, but a hip hop kind of background.
Yes.
Where dance music hadn't really taken off when I started work there.
It's interesting you say that, actually, because in the kind of mid 80s, even earlier 80s, people tend to think of the synth or electronic music as kind of Gary Newman's Depeche Mode, that type of thing. But there was this whole hip-hop breakdancing culture that was with electro music, which was more funky, but used synthesizers. So
yeah,
it was all like Afrika Bambaataa and like you mentioned there, the electro stuff, which, yeah, it doesn't really get as much praise as the more sort of British type of electronic music. But so going from there, you kind of got into the whole house music scene, wasn't it, really?
Yeah, I mean, I really kind of hit the going out stage around 1992, which was in the UK, the explosion of rave culture. It'd been there for a couple of years, but I think the real big event started happening then. I'm actually from Dunstable, and we had a sound system called Exodus, and that would involve waiting in the pub till 11, which is when they closed then, pretty much not drinking, which was weird, but you'd be driving, so that was fine. And we'd get in a convoy and drive for an hour and a half round different industrial estates and then end up in a warehouse that the guys had borrowed.
Yes, I remember them very well.
Yeah, amazing times, really amazing times. And the music that I experienced there really shaped what I love, to be fair.
So would you say then it was you got into the music and from there that kind of, as you said, it kind of shaped you. But was it that kind of drew you into the DJing side? Was it I want to be a DJ because I love the mixing, or is it because I want to look fantastic and be great? there is an element of ego, I suppose, isn't there?
The funny thing is, I think the DJing came before the music because I didn't have that wide knowledge of music. I think I discovered the Rolling Stones age 30, that kind of stuff.
Yes.
But when I joined middle school, the school library had a How to Be a Mobile DJ book in it, and I got that out the first week I joined the school, and I kept hold of it until I left. And I was fascinated by this concept of playing two records at the same time together to create this seamless version mix, if you like. In the days when mixing wasn't really mixing, I hadn't seen Grandmaster Flash or Greg Wilson's first bit on the TV, etc. So it, for me, it was just the segue in between two different songs, almost radio style, effectively.
Yes.
And that's what I wanted to be. So I'd grabbed the family's old turntable, and that perched on a ironing board was my first DJ console. I would be playing tracks onto recording onto tape, stopping the tape, playing the next, stopping the tape, playing the next, etc. And that must have drove my parents mad, to be fair. But it was the hobby that I liked. You know, yes. Other kids were playing football. I play in goal because I'm not that good. So music was my escape. Yeah, yes. Definitely.
No, I can identify with that, especially the football thing. You know, I was one of those that was last picked in the line. And they were justified, actually. But
Right, I great. Because I don't have to run.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. I like your style. Yeah, that was quite a good tip, actually. You put the record right at the back of the thing. I used to get all my records from Don Christie in Birmingham, and it was like a reggae shop, if you like. That's what it kind of prided itself, really. But it did have loads of imports and white labels, so I used to be there Saturday morning before they even opened just to get my vinyl. You know, good days, good days.
Yes.
Okay, so before I carry on and ask you some more and bring things up to date, of course, people in the chat room, we all know NAMM happened. There's been lots of products and things in NAMM and outside of NAMM. But at the same time, and of course, we can't escape Behringer. We can't escape their onslaught of the whole kind of synth world. Here we have them doing the Moog System 55, all the modules, which is incredible.
Hey guys, this is Guts from Behringer, and we've just introduced our System 100 Eurorack modules with that.
And the System 100 as well.
Well, some of you might like their sound to be even more vintage, so let's switch on the time machine and go back 10 more years. Introducing our Modular 55 series. We've got more than 20 modules for you, all authentic reproductions of the circuitry from the Modular 55, 35 and 15 series of the 1970s. And all brought...
So there he is. We've got Behringer coming out with modular gear now, which I think it wasn't much of a surprise. Maybe it was a surprise what it actually was and how much of it there is. They're just taking the synth world by storm, really. And I've no idea of the prices of those. I don't think they've announced them yet. But you're probably looking about £100, $100 per one. Now, you compare that to, obviously, because the likes of Moog do a System 15 and so on, all these. And they're not exactly the cheapest of products. Different. Maybe a different range of quality. Who knows? I don't know. But it's quite a ground-shaking announcement that they've done. Are you into it at all? Do you know much and do you follow much about the whole modular world?
I'm scared by it. To
be fair. Me too.
Yeah. Quite a few of the guys in the team are into modular stuff, and I've seen them obsess about particular modules, etc. One of the guys works and runs over in Bristol at Elevator Sound, so he's very, very into it. And watching an hour-long video of a singular drone doesn't really turn me on massively. I love breakbeats, so I don't think modular's ever going to work that well for me.
No, I understand. I've only got like five modules, and that's enough for me. That keeps me busy. But it's interesting, you know, that it's all coming out at a very cheap kind of price, which we presume it's going to be. Because some people are really, it's like a crack habit for, you know, modular. And if you can get all these modules, you'll have people just wallpapering their houses with modules. So there might end up being like a kind of Behringer recovery group or something. Like you have Alcoholics Anonymous, you'll have it for Behringer Anonymous.
Yeah, it's been 17 days since I bought my last module.
So, I mean, going, you know, bringing it back to kind of modern times for you. Now, Isotonik Studios, how did that come about?
Why? Dissatisfaction with equipment that I'd bought. I think in a nutshell, I got into Ableton Live. I wanted to play out with it because it's live. And I couldn't realistically find myself a setup that I was comfortable with, coming from a DJ background, that I could be spontaneous and not, you know, press play. And I've seen big acts press play, and yeah, they've earned their right to be up on that stage because of their music, but reading the crowd, playing different things than you had planned to do, so that's DJing for me.
That's the skill, isn't it? It is. It's reading that crowd and keeping them on that high a little bit longer, extend it. You've got that freedom. And then you're being creative as well, aren't you?
Absolutely. And I was club DJ for a decade or more, playing week in, week out, changing the music, etc. And losing that and going to live where it's almost pre-prepared, I think on my first gig, which was, really good, played well. Second one, the guy before me played at least five of the tracks that I'd prepared that I was going to play in my set. And of course, I had no backup plan to that. So the crowd heard those ones again. And it was at that point that I was like, right, there's got to be a better way of doing this. And I think at that point, I was traveling with a couple of Alan and Heath X-Zone 1Ds, but the first versions, they were the height of a Technics deck, and they were solid metal, no plastic involved. But they were just completely blank when it came to any form of mapping. So I'd even got to the point where I was printing my overlay with an X-Acto knife, cutting out the little bits, laminating it, and then putting it over, and it had my design on it. I probably spent more time on that overlay than I did on preparing my set, to be fair. And that's always been an issue for me, going off on a tangent and
we all do
getting
it.
Things done.
That's the creative in us.
Yeah. That's the bit that gives us relevance, I think. Yeah. That's the way it goes.
Yeah. So, I mean, like a lot of businesses, you see that there's a need, but you're not thinking of it as being a business at that point. You'll just have a problem and you want to solve it. And that's how it kind of grew.
Yeah, basically, I needed to be able to do more with the MIDI controller. The X-Zones 1Ds weren't it. And then I saw the APC-40 advertised for the first time, which had the first ring focus or red box in Ableton. For those that are aware of how Ableton works, it's got two views, the arrangement view, which is a traditional DAW where you lay out your tracks and modulate automation, et cetera, more like a composer view, if you like. Mm-hmm. It's also got a grid of clips in tracks and scenes, which you can trigger at will, and they all link into the set tempo of live. So you're always at this one tempo unless you change it yourself, but everything's perfectly synced, etc. And the APC-40, to my knowledge, is the first controller that had a grid of buttons that corresponded to what you saw on the screen. So I could go from scrolling, finding a scene, triggering a track, scrolling, moving, to having 40, which is why it was called APC 40, 40 clips. my friend Ray built one of the APC 80s, which took an APC 40 and an APC 20. Absolute battle monster of a controller, but probably not that portable, to be fair. Bolted the two things together as it came with like art wings on it. Very strange.
So it's got one for each hand, basically. Yeah.
Brilliant.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, that's a kind of skill in itself, is knowing what does what. I have enough trouble. I've only got like 15 buttons on this thing, and I always get it wrong for flicking the screens. But
flicking the screen. Yes, I do that when I'm trying to edit stuff in Premiere Pro, and you've got the multi-camera view.
Yes.
As you go through and you watch it and you real time edit it back in, and I'm always putting the wrong one on the screen, then stopping and going back. It's there's only three views, Darren. One, two, three. Crazy. But no, get off tangent again. The APC-40 was great, but didn't do everything I needed. So I used Bones MIDI translator, which I'm sure many of the watchers will have heard of. It really sparked my creativity for logic rules in programming, because I'm not a programmer, and I could work in the same kind of Excel view of the world.
Yeah.
If this equals this, then that, or else that. And I built a template that allowed me to do DJ things like looping and quite crude hot cues, etc. And I put that on video. and it's still on YouTube now. I can't remember how many thousands of views it has, but it was that video that was seen by someone at Ableton that meant I got an invitation to beta test Max for Live originally, which
right.
really is the kind of the start of that journey into becoming Isotonik Studios, to be fair.
Right. So it was kind of you had this problem, you decided to create something to solve it, that opened the eyes of other people within the industry, and Ableton wanted to talk to you about that a little bit further. So what was that kind of experience like working with them?
Ableton have been amazing, to be fair. They've promoted releases that we've had in the past by sharing them through their social groups for giveaways. They've promoted the free Git devices that we've done as well. I've been massively proud to be on stage at the last loop that was in Berlin. And I shared the stage with Madeline Bloom and Mika Frank from Pure Magnetic, and two people I look up to greatly in the Ableton world. So that was amazing. We met at Synthfest.
Because, we did. Yes.
Yeah, that was, I think Fortune was the first time, because Ableton had double booked themselves and so had a spare table at Synthfest and wondered if I would be gracious enough to represent them. And me and a few of the guys from the team, Ned Rush and Mark Towers, along with Phelan Kane, we kind of took our setups, set them up on the picnic tables and went, right, so this is a trade show. What do we do? it was magic.
It always seemed to be busy around you, though. I mean, I think it was the year before last then that I think we first sort of met. And then I was there last year, but I was last year, it seems like not that long ago, but I was filming the seminars.
Yes.
So I didn't get a chance to do any of the, you know, any of the sort of interviews and things like that. But so how was Synthfest for you?
Synthfest, this being our third year, we actually moved on to having our own table, our own stand. And that was a proud moment. And we found ourselves next to Novation and across from Ableton. And it was amazing. Yeah, it really was. Meeting the people that you've spoken to on email or on Messenger, etc., in real life, and the passion of the people that go to that particular show is incredible. And the people that were coming over, and maybe like yourself, I don't understand Ableton, I don't know where to start. They were just immense. But we did have a gentleman that Mark Towers, who was manning the stall with me, spoke to for 25 minutes and then he walked off. And Mark went, that guy's really familiar. Yeah, you just spent 25 minutes talking to a guy called Gerald, one of your childhood heroes. Yes. And you completely missed the opportunity. It was brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
It was funny, actually, because I filmed a guy called Gerald because he did the seminar. And interesting how he does his set. He keeps it live, but what he does, he uses two laptops with Reason on both of them.
Yeah.
But he doesn't sync them together. He just types in the BPM and then launches it live. And then he's changed. Yeah, just like DJing, but with these two. And it, you know, musically, everything was great in there. And he had this, I think it was an Alan Heath desk, and he was able to had two interfaces in it. So he was able to tune the bass, and, like, it wasn't the greatest sound system in there, but wow, he made it rock.
Yeah.
But, it does attract some interesting people. I know Phil Oakley came, well, he came on the Friday evening, actually. A number of sort of different people, but yeah, well, we'll talk about a bit more about some of the things that Isotonik does, things that it started, but I'm going to go back to some of the news, some of the other NAMM things. People are saying in the back, they've noticed about my wall. Where's all the gear gone from there? Well, I am actually moving out of this place, so whole kind of idea, it's because this is a weird shaped room, and I can't get all the cameras in to get better quality. So I'm just slowly breaking everything down and moving it to my new place while I kind of, not soundproof, but, you know, do a little bit of things so the neighbor doesn't kick off at me. But yes, it will, over the next coming weeks, it will reduce, and it'll get very echoey in here. But yes, Alan, I think that was, you noticed that. Eagle-eyed, some of these people, they really are. So going on to some of the new things. Of course, yes, we had Behringer doing that. I don't think I'll play the System 100 because it's in the same kind of vein. Of course, Dave Smith and Sequential. So there we have the news that Sequential are back with another monosynth, and this time it is a Pro 3. Now, I used to have a Pro 2, which used to sit over there, and I'll be totally honest, I did very, very little with it. I'm more of a poly kind of guy, playing chords one finger at a time isn't really me, but I've got loads of monosynths, but this thing looks fantastic. And sounds really good as well. It comes in two models. One that's, you can see there, that's kind of fixed. I'll see if I can find a thumbnail of it that shows both of them. It's probably at the end somewhere. Of course it isn't. Ah, there's the other one, if I can play. And it comes in that version there, which you can't see because I haven't got the screen up. But if you look here, you can see it's got this version, which is the traditional kind of mini Moog, and Matrix Brute kind of did something recently, a few years ago. So there we have it. Prices are around, if I take a look, about $1,600 for the fixed one, and like $2,100 for this one you can see on the screen now. So I don't know, people in the chat room, don't know what you think about this synth, the Pro 3. You're gonna kind of go for it? Marshall's in there, he'll probably will. He gets everything. I've got a fair bit of gear, but Marshall sort of puts me to shame. He's got that lovely 2600 pre-ordered as well, so good for him for that. So, don't know if anyone's going to get that. I probably will pass on the Pro 3. It does sound great. It does a lot. But, and of course, it has those three filters in there. Now, if they come out with the polysynth version of that, with the OB6, Prophet 6, and whatever ladder filter I think they've put in there, they do that as a polysynth, then we're talking very, very differently. And they need to do something to for that shameful Prophet X. I can't sell it. No one wants it. So, Darren, I don't know if you've had a chance to look over the Pro 3. No, it's end of the day. It's not. We kind of expected that something like this was going to come out by them. Basically what it was, you know, Sequential is owned by Dave Smith. He's from originally back in the day, for Sequential, created the Pro 1, which was a very iconic synthesizer and still is. Behringer recently did their clone version of it. They then brought out a Pro 2, now that's got to be around 2013, 2012, something like that, which was an all-digital affair for the oscillators. But now they're kind of updated to that. Interesting time, really. That there's so much gear now. That's the problem. There's so much new gear that's popped out that you don't know what to get, because no. You don't know if something else is going to come out with that.
That's part of the reason that I don't want to get involved, because I have a annoying habit of I want that and then I'll upgrade it and I won't use what I've got.
That's right. It happens too often. I mean, it's a bit of a cycle with whenever like NAM comes around or new gear comes around, because you know it is gas. You're looking at your existing gear. You're going, yeah, whatever. What's new and shiny that will solve the problem? Oh, God, and it's a never ending cycle, really. I suppose it's part of the hobby, if you like. But but anyway, going back to Isotonik Studio. So you've done some initial work with Ableton, and then you were demonstrating with them Max for Live. When was your kind of ping moment? This can be a company for me.
I've got to say, hey, Bo, by the way, I just seen her in the notes. There's a few. The pivotal moment that made me think this could be a business, I had released the device called Isotonik, which was originally a performance template for the APC 40. And I had a few nice email messages about it. And in those days, it was shared on Dropbox. So giving links out, God knows how secure that actually was. MaxForLive.com came along and it became the most downloaded device for a period of time. I still think it's in the top 20-ish. But out of the blue, I got mentioned in Future Music magazine and a check arrived from a guy called Ten Snake, as his artist name, who was using the template on his live tour. Hmm. And it was that money that I gave to a designer to come up with the first website. Which then launched with Isotonik as the APC 40 template, and Octopad, which was originally designed for a spec for an artist called Subfocus. I'm not sure if he ever ended up using it, because I kept adding and adding and adding more than he'd asked for in the first place. And that was it. I launched the website with those two products.
Wow. So it started pretty... It's funny because it started from a need for you to solve a problem, and that led you on to working with Ableton. But then artists getting in touch because of you, has the whole kind of artist integration with you, has that spurred on products, a lot of products?
To be fair, user feedback is the biggest blessing that I've had. I think follow XL, which is probably the sixth version that we've released of that. And on each iteration, we've taken users' feedback and put new features in and improved and improved and improved. It's very valuable to us. And that's why we take all forms of communication that people get sent through to us. And we now have a help portal, if you like, so that we don't lose track of any conversations as well. So yeah, that's massive, that user feedback. Worst thing in the world, putting your blood, sweat and tears into a product and then never hearing anything about it.
You're very, I mean, you know, I don't sell products as such, it's banks of sounds, you know, which of course you guys do as well. You do a variety of them, actually, looking at them, if I can see. So, I mean, in a nutshell, what would you say that the Isotonik kind of specializes in? And what's its categories or channels of products?
It would be hard to categorize it into one. It's easier just to say we specialize in Ableton Live. I have limited experience of any other DAW. I've played with Bitwig. Quite like Bitwig. I played with Fruity Loops, couldn't stand it, didn't like the look of it, and I'm sure lots and lots of people love it and hate Ableton. Sorry, Live. I get that wrong. Get taken off their Christmas list. That's Live, the company's Ableton. Absolutely. It's just grown. You said that the initial point was finding a problem. It's very personal to me and solving it, and that's my adult Sudoku rather than playing computer games. I self-taught myself Max for Live, which is based in Max, which is a graphical programming language. and that appealed to me rather than writing lines of code.
Yeah.
I tried that when I was 12 with Computer Magazine, writing out the entire code for Castle of Terror, I think I remember.
And then they never work.
Yeah, it took weeks and they never worked because I probably got a comma wrong somewhere, and that drives me mad. I love how Max allows me to learn as I create and test my theories as I go with the print messages and debugging, etc. I'd love to make this my full-time job and learn to code in C++ and all the other beautiful languages of Python, etc. But now that we've grown to where we are, I've got so many more talented developers that have got a lifetime's of experience.
Mm.
And if I've got an idea, they can realize that a lot more eloquently than I can. I'm in my, what's this now, my fourth house. I'm not decorating this one. Someone else can, because their results will be quicker and better than me. And I think that's the adult in me now.
Well, that's clearly, you know, the role of a leader is for that, is to identify the relevant people who can take that forward the right way, and on budget, on time, and to be able to respond to customers.
On time.
Yeah, oh, right. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I work with artists as well.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
The one thing that I learned very day one was there is no deadline until the product is delivered. That's it. You know, tend to work on the basis if the product's with me on a Friday, it can be prepared for a press release on the Monday, and then the mailer goes out on the Friday. But everything has to be ready. So the videos, the manuals, the product, everything. And some developers are really good at that and some are not so good. Let's leave it at that. I'm looking at you, Mark Towers.
So you, you've realized you can do more things and you need that talent from other people. Is it like, the traditional in a building, everyone together, or is it whole network of people all over the
that it'd be amazing. The business you are looking at is the end of my living room, and I mainly work from the table in the kitchen. The developers are Japan, Australia, all over Europe, in the UK. Literally there is no boundary to where you can get a Max for Live developer, in all honesty. The group, the collective, has grown, including the guys like Bo, who does the sound packs for the innovation circuit. We've got 30 plus members now. Not all have released stuff, but what we do have is a private Facebook group that's kind of like a support group as well. Because with Max and with Live, there's so many different ways of achieving the same thing, and nine are bad, one's really good, and finding that one that's really good is sometimes a challenge. So we often share the dramas and the challenges that we're having, and one member of the group will come up with an idea or will collaborate, and that's really satisfying, having the collective behind me, which Isotonik wouldn't be what it is today without that group of people.
That's interesting, because then you're utilizing the maximum of creative people and their skills, rather than, you know, the traditional interview somebody to come and sit down on a chair. You've got that whole flexibility, haven't you, really, to then develop these products and multi-products at the same time as well, I would have thought.
Yeah, absolutely. Certainly from my experience of developing, I'd spend between 2 and 3 months on a single product, would release it, there'd be a big high, a load of sales, and then you'd support that product, and then it started to drip down after a while. So I invited Ned Rush on board, because at the time I thought, well, he's got the same number of products as I have, and doing this jointly, we could spread out the releases over the year and we could support each other in that way. And I think I probably got betas of around 20 other products at the moment that the team are working on individually or collectively together. And that constant churn of new ideas and fresh ways is really exciting. Yeah, I love that part of the business.
Excellent, excellent. So, of course, you know, I personally don't use Ableton or Maxfit Live or anything. It's me. I'm the problem, not the software. You know, I just about managed to run Logic, let alone anything else. Coming back from the Cubase days on the Atari, but it seems to me that there's a lot of flexibility. It seems to be the most flexible bit of software or suite of tools to be able to use for the modern day sort of producer and gigging, you know, DJ or whatever like that. What kind of how I see is the integration with hardware, especially in some of those little kind of devices. Now, obviously, you say you know, you kind of specialize within live. What about kind of some of your tools? Are they able to be utilized by other DAWs, or is it just purely you just want to focus on that?
We have a singular VST in the store, which is Melody Source, which uses machine learning to analyze the top 40 dance hits and then create melodies for that. That's pretty much it that goes across other DAWs, yeah.
Yeah, well, all I'm thinking of, and it's just purely because of this whole stomping from Behringer with this these modules and things like that. Because there are some companies that provide software for integrating from the DAW plugin into CV and gate and things like that. I'm just wondering whether you've sort of thought about developing those, because modular doesn't seem to be getting smaller.
No, absolutely not.
And it would kind of make sense, especially with all those devices you can kind of make for Ableton, if that could then go, you know, through CV or
Absolutely. We have at the moment in the store, we've got a product called Modulat, which is primarily designed for the people who like tweaking things and LFOs and modulation, and they do not want to learn how to code. It's as simple as that. It's a set of modules that have been written in the most efficient CPU way. So you patch them together and use the signal to create a signal. And if you want to use that signal to affect all audio or parameters or send that to CV out, that can be done with Modulat. It's massive. That's the one. Massive what you can actually achieve with it, and it's awesome. But we're very aware from the feedback that we get from customers that Ableton Live attracts lots of people with lots of different levels of expertise, from the very, very beginner, which I still class myself in that way when it comes to production. I use Live primarily for live performance, for DJing, etc. So knowing the inside outs of the operator synth within Live, that I have limited knowledge. So I want tools that make it easier for me to do the things I want to achieve. There are others like Modulat level, which are professors, PhD kind of level. And then there's going to be others that come in at ClipX Pro level and others that Melody Source level. We try and not reproduce the same product, but we do definitively target different levels of expertise. So whilst Modulat covers, you know, the super amazing, you can achieve anything, we've got a product from Phil and Kane, MetaFunction, called Modular Junction, that's coming soon, that has all of that built in. And all you need to do is just click what you want to map it to. And that comes with even wavetable modulation as well. So quite excited for seeing that one released and how that will be received, as it comes with a CV version as well as parameter mapping version. And we held off that because Ableton themselves released the CV tools written by Skinnerbox, and that seems to have gone down amazingly well.
Yeah, I think I have heard of CV Tools. There's a couple of them. I can't remember the name. One of them, they've got a strange name. It'll probably come to me. But I think that kind of whole area, it's lacking in somewhere like Logic. But the whole area of integration into the hardware world. I mean, you do them with MIDI devices, don't you, as well? So, but you've got a huge amount of products. So I was looking through earlier on. And, you know, just starting from those couple that you had. And, of course, you mentioned earlier on then about the whole sort of machine learning. I wanted to ask you, really, what your whole thoughts on the machine learning is. I'm a little bit scared of it, but it's probably just my age. But but where do you see the positives in machine learning for going forward it could be in hardware instruments eventually, I suppose. But what's your view?
My view is meh, to be fair. Machine learning, meh. It's a buzzword. It's cool. We see adverts for Microsoft AI on the TV. Yeah, brilliant. Reproducing things programmatically from what humans have already created or not, I don't know. I think at the end of the day, there's going to be someone at that computer making a decision when they create the music. So if they use a tool like that, an arpeggiator to a degree is a tool that creates melodies that you maybe couldn't play yourself. So
true, very true.
It's where do we stop? And I'm yet to see a tool that will design the synth patch that I want to use, put the beat together, pull the composition together, the melody. You know, someone's probably working on one, and it will be great. And you know, we'll have all of 2 seconds of social media awareness when it gets launched before it goes down people's lists, and there'll still be artists.
Yeah.
People will still pick up a brush and some paint and paint. Why would you need to? You could just create it on a computer or let the computer create, you know, that's creativity. So machine learning, great. Meh.
I like the answer. I suppose in a way you kind of think of it like in the future they all want us to have driverless cars. It's like, well, I'm not going to pay 30-40 grand for a car I can't drive. You know what I mean? So why buy a bit of software
that has the lane assist?
Yeah,
and it stops you moving out of the lane.
Yeah,
and I've turned it off because the first time I tried to move across the lane and it's fighting against me, I'm like, oh no,
that's not right.
No.
Yeah. Some chip knows more about driving than you. I don't think so.
No,
I guess the only thing for me is the you know, because what I do is obviously I make sounds, and the thought of like someone just going, all right, okay, let's model Jamie's style of making patches and then apply it to any synth. I mean, I suppose that could be a product, but it's certainly scary.
I'll ask the team to see if they can come up with that.
Well, once they figure out how I make patches, let me know as well. I don't know. It's a strange process that I go through. But anyway, we'll come back to that some more. Videos that have come out. This one here, this one kind of caught my eye, which was probably one of the first ones that was announced at NAMM, and that's Nord. They're back with a synthesizer. They haven't done one for a while. I think the last one was the Nord A1, which I do have, and I've made patches for. But then they've come out here with the Nord Wave 2. So it's not exactly a synthesizer there, but synth sounds. Here we go. Now, for some people, Nord synths are a bit Marmite. You either like it or you don't like it. And we're all, you know, everything's been analog recently. Getting some digital synths coming back through. Now, I've liked Nord gear because it's got a fair amount of voices that you can play, and you get four layers. And you can, what I did with the A1, I treated each layer rather than an individual synth, I treated them like an oscillator. So I could have four oscillators to create one sound in the performance mode. But what they've added here, it's essentially got the A1 synth engine. It's got wavetable, it's got FM, and it's got sample playback. Nothing really new as such, but a new kind of combination of them. I don't know if you had a chance to have a look at and listen at anything like this. You probably were too busy with your Ableton stuff, but...
I've just recently got rid of some gear, including a Roland JD XA, which had the eight digital voices, and
yes,
the standard noises out of it were amazing, but yeah. You know, you could just get so lost, and
it can be a little bit
good at making noises. I'm not sure I like them all.
Yeah, well, I'm a little bit like that with all these bloody things that I do. But don't know if people in the chat room, don't know if there's the wave has interested any of your ideas. If you're thinking of getting something like, it's about $2,500, maybe something like that. I don't know. I mean, a lot of gear at the moment. There's so much of it coming out.
$2,500.
Yeah, so I think it works out about £2,150. That's what I've been seeing them come up for, which sounds a fair bit. It is a fair bit.
Small car.
It is a small car, but if we kind of look at it that way, I've got a huge car collection.
Look at the background.
Yeah, it's
the one series.
Yeah, it's but I don't know. I'm quite interested in this one, but it is more of a keyboard player's type of synth. But of course, everyone in the chat room, if you've got any questions for Darren, by all means, please ask away. And if I see them, then I will put them to him. But so out of all the products that you've got, what would you say is the one that, well, interesting is, what would you say is the most popular, but what's your kind of favourite?
Yeah, I was dreading this question. This is like being asked who is your favourite child, which is obvious it's George, because Dan's grown up and left home. But that would have been difficult before. If I have to narrow it down, I'd still have to pick a few. One of my favourites, and definitely the most popular, is the ClipX Pro product, which isn't a Maxwell Live device. It's a control surface script, but it's one that allows you to write your own scripts effectively. Yeah. So you can write actions into clip names and trigger the clip and have Live perform multiple things at the same time. So muting three tracks, arming another, launching a clip, and resetting the parameters of a device on that track. It's really taken off. It for many years, ClipX, I'm never sure which is the best way to pronounce it. I must ask Stray properly. Was a free program, a free script and utility, and I was so pleased to be able to launch ClipX Pro through Isotonik Studios, and it's just keeps on growing the number of users, and we've got a Facebook users group as well, and right. There's some awesome moderators in there that are so passionate that people come on with challenges of I want to achieve X, and they not only solve it but come up with three different ways of doing it as well. And at the moment I'm just playing around with the beta with some OSC stuff on the iPad to be able to do a set list from cues, etc. That's again, it's like Live in the what you put into it, you get out.
Yeah.
So as long as you're willing to work through the lessons first, there's a learning curve, but as soon as you've figured out, I want to target that track, I want it to do that, followed by that, then it's a doddle to work with. And it comes with a couple of upgrades as well, which includes bindings, which is what I'm using in my current live performance setup, which allows me to MIDI map at a level above live. Mm-hmm. So I can take those MIDI maps across sets or saved templates, if you like, and I can switch that MIDI mapping on the fly. So if I want it to map to the current device's first 8 parameters, I can press a button, I can move to a send track and correct and look after the device on there. It's really appealing to me because it means I don't have to learn how to write Python, but I can achieve control surface script effects with it. From an audio effect point of view, I pretty much has given up using Max for Live to code my own audio effects because of Modulat. So I like the toolboxy stuff that allows me to do things. Production wise, really Mark Tower's arcade series, and in particular Polypin, which is a Euclidean sequencer, and I always have to check that I've got that right. Which
I'm not going to attempt that word.
That's the one. That one actually has just been relegated out of my set to be replaced with the Euclidean sequencer for the Akai Fire, which Mark has produced, which we were showing off at SynthFest this year. Yeah. If you've seen the Akai Fire, it's now, I think it's a $99 controller that with the script from Stray Crossfire turns it into a mini push. You've got session view, drum view, 16-step step sequencer, and it just feels really easy to get on with. So, yeah, there's three of my favorites, and not one of those I programmed myself. So.
Well, it's funny because Jazz in the chat room has asked what has turned out to be the most difficult or hardest to program, obviously with your developers and so on. What's turned out the most challenging of all?
I think that a product called Predator, which is by Sigable or Lee Huddleston, that basically dives into Live's remote scripts and enables you to create your own auto mappings of how the parameters appear on the push screen when you focus on the device. The challenge of that one is that Ableton keeps updating scripts, keeps updating them with every new version. They will probably break something that works in that product. So both Lee, myself, and quite a few members of the team, we're all crashologists, which are alpha testers for Live. And that's all we can say about that because, you know, virtual yes. crashologist club, etc. But we're also beta testers for Max for Cycling 74. So we tend to have a good heads up of when things are going to break. But the control surface scripts is something that is plagued with challenge through changes because none of it seems to be documented ever.
Because that must be your biggest challenge, really, is those changes that you're not in control of because someone else has changed something, and you get probably a small amount of lead time to be able to react to that. Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, there's even some calls on some control surface scripts, especially the push, that have been coded to give you an error message that says, please do not rely on this. This may break at any time. So if you're happy to release a product that relies on something that may break at any time, that's up to you. I've probably retired a couple of products that, you know, they were great, but I've got a Mac, I've got Windows, I can't test on every single OS version that's ever existed, and that's where I rely on our beta testers group. But if Live does a quick iteration of versions and you're not testing against the version next and the one after it, it's always going to be a challenge where you let down customers, and we never want to be in that position, to be fair.
No, I mean, it sounds like you've got a whole lots of manufacturers could learn a lot of lessons from you, because you've got that whole interaction with your customers, and it's a two-way street. You're getting those ideas from them, and you're learning from them, and you're developing products for an audience that already wants it. So, you know, it's a bit of a win-win, isn't it, to a degree? At least there's a big journey throughout that. But that's quite it's quite a unique thing, actually.
It's very satisfying.
For the amount of products that you have, it's certainly, even, you know, we may hear some companies that will, you know, I'm talking in terms of hardware synthesizers, that may interact, but there's not on that kind of level of interaction where they set up a support group, and that whole, it's a short distance from an idea and feedback, rather than being hidden behind companies, especially the Japanese companies are a bit like that. But it sounds like that's kind of been, you know, a huge spur for your company.
Yes. Definitely. That interaction is essential. And I mean, I get up in the morning and probably the first thing I do shouldn't be to look on my phone, but it's to check to see if we've had any messages in overnight, whether the ones that we had yesterday, which were assigned to developers, whether they've been responded to, chasing the guys. You know, it's very satisfying.
Now, of course,
I wouldn't do it if I wasn't passionate about it.
Well, no, exactly. I mean, what I do, I just work on sound, so it's very a lot smaller. But are you able to switch off from it? Because it is a 24/7 world, isn't it? Can you switch off?
Let me just go and get my wife. She should probably answer that one. Yeah, no, Claire has been with me from the beginning and has been the reason that I've got this far, because she will tell me when to stop, when to switch off. She knows that even when I have left the office in the kitchen and come in the front room, that my brain is still thinking, what's the answer to that problem that I had previously? But she will look me in the eye and tell me to stop it now. And that helps. That helps to have that division. And certainly 2019, I took an active decision to pull back from doing the hours that I do. I've got a full-time day job, which is very occupying. And then I'd come home and I'd do like 3-4 hours, and 9 o'clock, I was still at the computer answering a support request, but trying to code products, etc. And last year, I pulled back from that many hours and focus more around how I was going to organize my day and week and month and releases, etc. And I got a hell of a lot of time back to spend with the family, and I'm hoping this year will be even more. Relying on other people is difficult for me to do as an individual, but it's been the thing that has changed my business in the last 12 months, to actually outsource the website, not day to day, but the website functionality, the server, etc. I was spending hours getting things wrong and cocking things up, and I just happened to find a ex-DJ rival of my own that did a different night on the nightclub. He went off and he became more techie, etc. And he looks after the website constantly. Yeah. Pulling the packs together for Ableton Live. One of the guys in the team now, we supply him with the manual. He builds the lessons. So Perform Module, who's done some awesome articles on how to manage Ableton Live like a boss, which is the whole file structure of it. He creates our live packs that they install directly into the user's library. I could have done it probably, but having that backup and being able to rely on those other people is so important to me. And that's kind of the indication to me in the last 12 months that we've grown past it just being me doing everything.
Yeah, that's and it's the only way, I suppose, a business can grow anyway. You can't be, you know, micromanaging every single aspect, because you just, like you say, you'll spread yourself too thin and everything will just become too much. So it sounds like you've got that kind of sorted. So I was going to ask you, within the whole kind of music industry, I mean, you go to, like you mentioned, Synthfest and so on. What's the good and not so good points about the music industry that you found?
One word: manners.
Right, okay. Mm. Is that a good or a bad thing?
It's the answer to both, to be fair. Obviously, I run a website and a day job as well. That things don't always work. Certainly with plugins on websites, etc. I'm constantly getting onto the support guys and asking for help, etc. So things do go wrong. You can't program for every single variety and setup in the world. And just having manners when you make a request for help, that goes a hell of a long way. I have kept clippings of some of my most outrageous support requests. At some point, I'll put them up under a fake name on Instagram or something. but it does seem, and I know we live in a society where digital and it's almost faceless in some ways, but there's always a human being at the end of that message that you're typing and sending, whether it's a comment on a YouTube video or it's a direct email into a company. There's someone at the other end that's going to read that and is going to be affected by the message that you send. And manners go a hell of a long way. I understand frustration totally, but and that I've found that quite prevalent in the music industry.
Yeah.
A level of entitlement that people believe for the £5 that they've spent that, I'll stop there.
No, I totally understand it. I mean, we're kind of talking shop here. I get it as well. It'll be somebody who will have a certain synthesizer that I've made patches for, and because they bought that synth, they feel like they're entitled to my sounds. And they'll put just today I had somebody say, why would anyone buy patches? Just make your own to be original. And I'm thinking, well, if you think that, why have you bothered writing it on my YouTube go?
It's like you've someone, wasted about 10 seconds. You could have made a patch.
And, I mean, it's like somebody coming. It's like someone's coming to my house, knocking on the door, and say, "Your curtains are crap. They wouldn't look good in my house." You know what I mean?
I don't like your car. I wouldn't want to drive it. Right?
Yeah. Well, you knocked on my door.
Good manners cost nothing.
It's very true. It's very true. Luckily, I don't get it too often, but I get the usual things and some dodgy scams that people try to get my sounds for nothing. There's some horrible people out there.
The best flattery is when one of your products actually ends up on one of the Wares sites and you have to do a DMCA violation takedown request thing. That's a little bit of a bane of my life, but hey, you bought it, why not share it with the world?
Yes, that's probably a private discussion, actually. We could probably
I've got a nice legal letter. I'll send it through to you.
You say that for both having good kind of manners. I mean, obviously, you must have, with the things like the trade shows, made lots of connections both with the industry but also with other artists. I mean, you mentioned a few artists before. What kind of people, sort of, is it producers really, or what?
To be fair, I would suggest that most of our customers are producers or wanting to take their productions live, so looking at the performance side of things. In the beginning, I was quite noisy on Twitter and the like and would hound artists that I respected for their music when they'd post up, I want to be able to do this. And I'd rush to offer the solution and work with them. And I was very fortunate. I did some stuff for Breakage and Funk Agenda, who both turned out to be really cool, amazing guys. And I've worked a lot with sort of smaller bands looking to improve their live show and their performance. Mm-hmm. Probably the largest deal contract wise is when I worked recently again with Matthew Miller, who's the MIDI tech engineer for Coldplay, and they've been unknown to me using our launch sync product in their live shows for quite a few years, and that was
if you could get a testimonial for things like that. Yeah, wow,
it is.
yeah that's from your sort of sales marketing background and things like that, you know, that's gold, that sort of stuff. But
of course, I did ask the direct question, but as you probably are aware, Coldplay famously take the logos off of their sound equipment before it goes on stage.
It's I've never understood that sort of stuff. I've never understood why people put tape over the back of things like that. It's like, it's the most bizarre thing anyway. I suppose
it's almost reversed, though. You see a Nord red keyboard on stage, and it's like, you see a Nord red keyboard that someone's plastered across. What is that?
Exactly.
It's reverse engineering.
If you're a synth nerd, you're going to know what a synth is even by just looking at the screw or something like that. You know what I mean?
It's got an extra knob. That would throw people. Start gluing extra knobs to
your put different knobs on. Speaking of knobs, actually, no, I'm not going to go there. Don't worry. somebody asked earlier on, I think it was Alan, about what's in your case behind you. You got something, some kind of thing right behind your head there on the left hand side.
The other thing.
That. Ah. Well, what are they?
Right. So this is, I just recently wrote an article reviewing the decade for DJ Works. I'm part of the team there where, to be honest, I contribute little bar annoying the chief. Mark Settle to get things done, but this in my review of the decade was my MIDI controller of the decade, because it is the you can see that, not quite, there we go, the MIDI Fighter Twister. It's by DJ Tech Tools. It's a 4x4 grid of knobs. What makes this different, and this harks back to my first sort of controller that started this off, the APC 40. It's got the rings around each knob, which are LEDs, which if you switch what these are controlling, it will change the LED. So you'll always see what the value is.
That's good.
The difference in this controller, as opposed to the various ones from the other manufacturers that I've used, is its configurability. It's got three pages of MIDI that you can bank through, because it's got side switches. The editor that comes with it allows me to set each of these press buttons and the send and the knob itself to a huge variety of MIDI messages.
Yeah.
Now, if you look at MIDI controller editors, they normally are either non-existent.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to support that kind of thing, or they're fairly basic, so you can change it to a note or a CC.
Yeah, they don't go into NRPNs or SysX or any of those type of things, yeah.
This, I can set this up, so this button here works on a MIDI note hold basis, or a MIDI note toggle basis, or a MIDI note momentary basis.
Yeah.
So this one set of, 16 press buttons, 16 knobs, I can recreate any controller pretty much that's out there from a testing perspective, and it's smaller than my head, so it fits in a bag and it can go anywhere with me.
So it sounds like the Swiss Army knife of controllers.
That's it. Okay. Bot on. And you know what's the Fighter Twister? Two!
excellent. So
smug Darren at that point. That for me, I work on an 8-track basis, so having the 8.
That it's logical for you. You can see it, can't you?
I can see it. And I learned pretty quickly that having pages of functionality with shift control combinations, I'm not good at Street Fighter, and there's a reason for that. I want one simple set of controls. I want to know when it's in this page, it's doing X. When it's in that page, it's doing Y.
It's the feedback.
So, feedback, and that's essential. So my current live setup is those. And I'm utilizing at the moment either the Push 2 with the P2D session product that puts the session view of live on the screen, or the Akai Force, which is in the early stages of its integration with live, but with its touch screen and the NPC background. That one's really cool at the moment. Loving that.
Excellent, excellent stuff. I think I've got one more bit of synth news. Well, actually, it's probably a couple of things. Let me move over to here. First of all, yeah, this is just a little bit of add-on. Modal have announced these extra synths or versions of their synths, because I nearly went for this one here, the first release version, but they're coming out with a 61 note version and a module. Not so much interested in the module, but the 61 note. Usually when they add like another octave, they usually add like £200 or £300 or dollars extra, but this only seems to be, you know, less than £100 more. So I might hang on for that one rather than getting the first one, but then again, it all depends on the room. This is my favorite synth demonstrator, which is Daniel Fisher, and he's got the Moog Subsequent 25.
Daniel Fisher here at Sweetwater Sound, and today I am knocked out to show you the new Subsequent 25 analog synthesizer by Moog.
So this is a bit of a strange one. I did see a comment of someone saying it's getting nearer to the David Guetta synthesizer. And the David Guetta synthesizer sort of meme is there's just like two or one note on the keyboard or something. It seems like, to me, it's filling the gap of the original Sub Fatty, which is a similar form factor, but then they've come out with this, which follows the... It's a weird-looking thing. Sounds good, but it's very a strange move, I think. But it's about $850, so that'll probably equate to about the same thing in pounds, really. So going back to things that you're doing in your company, Isotonik Studios, I mean, I'll just show, actually, we've got... you've got your... Obviously, your website, but you also have a YouTube channel with... dozens and dozens of videos on there going into detail about the products and support of those, installation of them and Q&A and all that kind of thing. You also have your Facebook page where people can contact you. So what's the kind of future for Isotonik Studios?
Right. Well, the stuff I'm working on at the moment, I retired a product called the DJ Collection a couple of years ago because the live API wasn't up to what I was trying to achieve at the time. That's been redone, and much of the support requests for that product came from it works with the push, but I want it to work with X controller or Y controller, but it was very much linked into the push. So I've rebuilt that and it works like the pad modes of Serato. So you've got hot cues and looping and a slicer. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the Max for Live stuff that I'm working on personally. Always interested in new developers coming on board, and I've probably got four that are ready-ish with new products to come out. I've mentioned the stuff in MetaFunction, that's pretty exciting. From a synth-esque world, Dan, who runs the Patches website, is working on a set of tools for randomization and sound design of Live's inbuilt synths, if you like. So they're really, really cool. I want to do loads more videos. You've touched on it. There's nearly 200 products in the store now, and getting people to know what product does what is always going to be a challenge with that many. And recently I started doing some videos that weren't necessarily linked to a product, but more about how I'm building my live performance set, which are called the Isotonik Studio Sessions, which is the name of the original podcast that was just me mixing and putting mixes out on Mixcloud and the like. So I want to carry on doing those, how the different products we have and those that are out there as well, how they can be brought together to build stuff. Just demonstrating one product at a time sometimes can be limiting. It's how people use things in the real world.
That's very interesting, actually. Yeah, it'd be good to see how, as well, artists use your products. If it's like day to day things, just speeding up their workflow, or whether it's something that gives them that little creative edge. Of course, some of them may not want to, stick the tape over the name again, but in the kind of virtual world. But
we get a spike in sales anytime one of our products is used within one of, is it Fact magazine that does the 10 minute challenge?
We had
Polypin in that a couple of times. And it's been involved in a few YouTube demonstrations. And I think Factor Synth the other day was used in one of those, and people see it and it's, oh, that's how I use it.
Yeah.
They might not watch a tutorial.
It is. It's demonstration, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is demonstration, but it's also got to be quick for them to learn. None of us. I mean, in the synth world, we've got kind of reviewers like Lupop, who reviews some of the latest synthesizers. And his videos are like video manuals. And you learn things in there that are in the manual, but you also learn things that the manufacturers haven't even thought of. So it's like you watch his videos. They may go on for 20, 30 minutes, but then you don't need to open a manual. Everything's there. And I think that's because we know people have got shorter attention spans, or it's more there's so much going on to take up their attention. To take that time, that sort of doing that quick access to information and demonstration. Yeah. You know, you get this, and in 10 minutes, this is how such uses it. It's definitely a great idea.
Yeah, the suggestion is about 5 minutes is the sweet spot. But
if
a video for me normally is about 15 minutes, and in that time I don't feel I've waffled greatly, I think I've done an okay job. So that I want to spend a lot more time doing that. Apart from the microphone not working today, I've upgraded the sound, the video, the production qualities. I wanted to step up above the usual screen share tutorials that I've done in the past. I'm really looking forward to using more of the Akai gear. The Force is as a standalone is great fun. As a live controller is hampered in certain ways, but it's only on first release of the beta. And myself and Sigabolt, one of the developers, we're hoping to add a lot more to that in the coming weeks, months, probably months.
Excellent. One thing I was going to ask, I kind of asked this, what's one thing about you that people don't know? Without being too personal, obviously, but
That's the one question that's still on my list as unanswered. So when I think of a decent answer to that one, I'll post it back in the comments.
That's a good way of getting out of it, definitely.
The E in my middle name stands for Ernest. And
Ernest.
That's my dad's name and his dad's name and his dad's name and his dad's name. So,
So it's followed in the Cowley line then, has it?
Very much so. Unfortunately, it ends with me, but those are the breaks.
Yeah, excellent. Well, I think we've pretty much come to the end of the stream. Thank you very much for joining, Darren.
Checking out to the end of the bottle as well. So
you're at the end of the bottle as well. So that's like your egg. That's like your egg timer. Is the it's the bottle. I just want to, of course, people, while we've got the last few sort of minutes, if there's any questions you've got for Darren, then by all means ask away. I thought it was quite good to have like a owner of a business that provides tools. I mean, yes, it's not exactly just synth related, but the whole music production thing is all, you know, it's all integrated. And I thought it'd be very good. So, again, thank you very much for joining. Now, see what some of the people have seen in the chat room. What we got? Blade Runner, that's very cruel of you. He just said, can we talk about synthesizers now?
Synths are great.
Yeah, synths are great. And what we got there? I don't think there's much more I can pull out for there. So, yeah, once again, Darren, thank you very much for joining. And just to say, next week I've got, who is it? I think it's Torsten and Chris that's back on. Coming up in the future, I've got DivKid coming on. And I've got Ken Flux Pierce coming on. So there'll be guests in the future next month. There will be a bit of time when...
Blade Runner, yeah.
You what, sorry?
Much more synthy for Blade Runner.
Yes, yeah, I know. It's, I don't know. I mean, I'm obviously a sound designer, so that's kind of what people kind of expect, really. But I like the idea of spreading it out a little bit more and going into more of the whole sort of music production side as well, because... Once you've talked about filters, what else is there? You know what I mean? It's all the same bloody stuff, end of the day.
Compressors.
Yes, compressors, yeah. Okay, yeah, you know, it's a tricky old thing. Can't please everybody. But, John says, Jamie, how is your new summit? It's very good, thank you very much. Just can't really talk too much about that, but, yeah, it's very good. So, yeah, thanks very much. And, guys, I'll see you next week. And that's about it. So, thanks very much and goodbye.
Bye.